Hello, so I'm going to be talking to you about the work we've been doing on the mapping of transient brain network dynamics, particularly from a multimodal perspective. And over the last sort of decade or more, there's been a huge amount of work done mapping large-scale brain networks, particularly using the technique of FMRI in the resting state. So resting state's been particularly successful in its application because it allows you to conveniently investigate the intrinsic nature of brain networks in a very simple experimental format. And people have used fMRI to characterize these networks with ever more exquisite spatial detail, using the information they get from these networks to predict clinical states and behavioral traits in individuals. But I think it's fair to say that the work that's being done with fMRI tends to be somewhat from a static perspective. And by that I mean people would typically average the brain activity over the course of an entire scanning session to get a time average brain network. But of course, the brain is a highly dynamic system producing cognition on sub-second timescales. So it seems reasonable to assume that what's underlying this set of time average brain networks are these inherently time-varying transient brain networks, which are coming and going over time. And it's only when you average the brain over the course of a scanning session, for example, you get a somewhat different impression that this time average brain network is the meaningful entity. So the work I'm talking about today will be looking to develop techniques that allow us to identify and characterize these transient brain networks, and importantly, the dynamics describing how these networks switch over time. So the approach I'll be looking to use for doing that will be based on the technique of hidden Markov modeling. This allows us to take data recorded from multiple brain regions in new imaging data, for example, and to describe that data as a sequence of brain states, where each state is characterized by a distinct functional brain network. And so importantly, the HMM can find both what these networks look like, but also when these networks are activating in time. So this might be brain state one, and then at other points in time, the brain visits other network states where each one's characterized by its own distinct functional brain network. So we can use the HMM on a bunch of different types of data. It's very flexible. Today, I'm going to talk about non-invasive neuroimaging data and start with an application in fMRI. And so we're going to try and use the HMM to go beyond this static perspective I mentioned earlier to see if we can infer dynamic networks in resting fMRI data and see if we can relate the dynamics to behavior. So the first thing I'm showing you here are the spatial maps for 6 of the 12 states that we inferred on the human connectome project resting state data. And these show the same mix of primary sensory motor and cognitive networks that we're used to seeing in the resting state. And so the new perspective really comes when we look at the dynamics of these network states. And we can summarize those dynamics using different summary measures. For example, the fractional occupancy that tells you about the amount of time you spend in a state, or the interval time between state visits. And here I'm showing you the lifetime of the state, so the amount of time you spend in a state before you move into a new state. And you can see here that the typical lifetimes are quite quick, they're on the order of 5 or 6 seconds. And that's kind of at the same time scale as the effective temporal resolution of the fMRI data, which by the nature of the fact it's measuring a vascular response, doesn't really have information content much faster than this 5 or 6 second time scale. So we're seeing the HMM finding dynamics on timescales as fast as we could expect to go in the fMRI data. We then wanted to see if we could identify interesting temporal structure in the dynamic sequences of states, or whether it's just completely random. And for this, we can look at the transition probability matrix that the hidden Markov model provides us. And this tells us about the probability of going from any one of the states of the 12 we inferred to any other of the 12 states. And we can do a modularity analysis to investigate this further. But what we find when we do that is that the states split into two distinct subgroups, or metastates, as we call them. And one metastate, labeled metastate one here, corresponds to primary sensory motor network states, shown in green and blue. And the metastate two corresponds to higher order cognitive networks, shown in yellow and red here. And so there's a tendency for the brain to cycle either between cognitive network states or between primary sensory motor network states, with a much lower probability of switching between those two subgroups. So given this very distinct subgrouping of the network states into these metastates, we were interested in seeing if the amount of time that an individual spends in a metastate was predictive of behavior. And what we found was that people who spend more time in the cognitive metastate are more likely to be associated with positive psychological traits. And those who spend more time in the sensory motor metastate are more likely to be associated with negative psychological traits. And we also found using the twin structure in the human connectome project data that the time spent in metastate was also heritable. So that's the investigation so far in fMRI. And you know, the chief thing we found is that the network dynamics seem to be very quick by fMRI standards on this kind of 5-second timescale at their fastest. But this, of course, is still very slow compared to what the brain can do on a sub-second, 100 millisecond sort of timescale. And so to get at these kind of fast sub-second dynamics, we need to turn to other modalities like electrophysiology. So here we're going to look at some approaches of the HMM to MEG data, or magnetoencephalography. And we're looking at data that's in the low frequency range between 4 and 30 hertz. And this is because this has been shown to be a good frequency range to find good connectivity when we take the time averaged approaches that I mentioned earlier. So when we do this, we find again a good mix of primary sensory motor and cognitive networks that we typically see in the resting state. But again, if we look at the dynamics of these networks, we can see very fast switching on these sub-second timescales. And if we look at the 8 states that were inferred here, we can see that in the first 10 seconds, for example, we see every single state is visited multiple times. And indeed, if we look at the lifetimes of these states, we can see lifetimes on the order of 50 to 100 milliseconds. So we're seeing these resting state networks switching on timescales orders of magnitude faster than have been shown previously using other approaches. So we followed up this work with an investigation into the extent to which there were networks of synchronization in the resting MEG data. And the idea here was that these very fast switching dynamics, these very fast visits to these network states might reveal phase locking that's very short-lived. And that's what we found. We found these networks of synchronization exhibiting phase locking between brain areas that were co-activating in the networks. And this is kind of a slightly new finding, because previously people had struggled to find strong phase locking networks in resting states. We think because they were looking at too slower timescales previously, and with the HMM we can access these fast timescales. And of course, synchronization is an important potential mechanism of communication across the large areas of the cortex. So we saw earlier on about how we can use properties about the dynamics of the brain networks to predict behavioral traits in the fMRI work. Here we're going to do a similar thing with the MEG, looking at clinical states. This is work done by David Salat's group from MGH. And he took HMM and applied it to the MEG data he had, and found that in Alzheimer's disease, the brain seems to spend less time in the default mode and the dorsal attention network states in the resting MEG compared to healthy controls. So this is another good example of how we can use the properties about the dynamics of the networks rather than the strength of connection that's been classically used from the time averaged approaches. So far we've shown that we can access dynamics in these networks on the kind of slow 5-second timescale with fMRI. And with MEG, we can access much faster timescales on the 50-100 millisecond timescale. But what's the link between these two, these slow and fast timescales? So the most obvious link between them is that the resting MEG network state time courses have within them long range temporal structure, which when you pass that through the low pass filtering properties of the hemodynamic response function, results in meaningful fMRI network state fluctuations on the slow fMRI timescales. So this is a testable idea. We can't do it with simultaneous MEG and fMRI data, but we can get EEG and fMRI data simultaneously. That's technically possible. And this is what Tatiana Sitnikova and colleagues did fairly recently. They acquired concurrent fMRI and EEG data, computed EEG HMM network states, which looks pretty similar to what we've seen previously with the MEG. They took the network state time courses and convolved them with a hemodynamic response function and correlated the resulting time courses with the fMRI data. And they found from doing that, there were good spatial maps in the fMRI that corresponded well with the spatial maps in the EEG network states. And so this is a confirmation that, at least to a reasonable extent, that this relationship is true. And as I mentioned before, this can only be true if there is long-range temporal structure in these MEG, EEG network state time courses, such that that long-range temporal structure survives the low-pass filtering of the HRF. And indeed, we can directly go looking for this long-range temporal structure by using certain measures. For example, here we've used the Fano factor, which captures the extent to which state visits in the MEG network state time courses burst or cluster in time at long fMRI timescales. And that's indeed what they do. Okay, so I'm going to finish the talk by looking at the application of the HMM to the field of replay. And I'm sure many of you are familiar with the field of replay, but briefly as a recap, it's been largely studied in animal world, in animal literature. In particular, for example, you might have a mouse running around a maze, and as they follow a particular route, you'll see a sequence of play cell activity firing in the hippocampal CA1 play cells. But what's interesting is that when the mouse is then subsequently at rest, you'll see the same sequence of play cell activity playing out spontaneously in the resting state. So reactivating, replaying what the mouse was doing when they were active earlier. So this is thought to be important for consolidating and augmenting memory or learnt experiences. So recently it's been shown that we can identify replay non-invasively in humans using MEG. Rather than having humans run around a maze, we have them learning sequences of visual images during a behavioral part of the experiment. We also have to pre-learn a brain decoder that can identify from the MEG data what visual images are being represented at any one point in time. And that's done with some MEG functional localizer data. And then, so once we have this pre-trained brain decoder, we can apply it to the resting state's MEG data after the sequence learning and find if there's reactivation of the learned sequences, in other words, replay. And it's been shown that this is the case. You can find replay significantly, and it's been replicated now in a couple of studies. So we wanted to take this ability to identify replay events in the resting state MEG and link those replay events in terms of their timing to the dynamics we can extract from the same resting state data about the large scale resting state networks. And this will allow us to essentially link together the field of RSNs to the field of replay. And there's reason to think this is possible because we can access both of these things on similar timescales. So we essentially take the network state time courses inferred on the resting data and align them to the replay events also inferred on the same data. And when we do this, we can see that there's two particular network states that show an increase in occurrence in the 100 milliseconds or so around replay. And these correspond to the default mode network and to the parietal alpha network, as we refer to it. This essentially incorporates parietal regions and the PCC with strong power in the alpha band. What's also interesting about these networks is that they also are the ones that exhibit the most network-wide synchronization, brain-wide synchronization, particularly the default mode network. So what do we think is happening here? Well, we think that perhaps what the brain is doing is it needs to be able to allow replay to occur sort of uncontaminated by ongoing cognition and processing of incoming stimuli. And so the parietal alpha network could well be switching on to inhibit bottom-up sensory processing of incoming visual stimuli, for example. And then at the same time, the default mode network is going to need to coordinate the actual replay, and it does so using these brain-wide high levels of synchronization. So hopefully I've given you a flavor of what we can do with multimodal investigations, particularly using the HMM to link across multiple timescales and different modalities. It's a very flexible technique that can be used to do that. And with replay, we saw how we can go from 50 millisecond information about replay in animals and link that to large scale network dynamics in MEG. And then through simultaneous EEG and fMRI data, we can then link that through to the slower fMRI timescales. And overall, by doing this, we can link the field of replay to the field of large-scale resting state networks in fMRI. And I'll just finish by saying a big thank you to all my collaborators. And thanks for listening.